against the motion.
Well, speaking in Kolkata, how can you not refer to Mother Teresa? And since I know, as my colleagues there may not be aware, particularly one of them, that this is not Karan Johar's Coffee with Karan. It's not even a chai pe charcha. It's not even a cappuccino pe charcha. It's a cappuccino's ke beyond ki charcha maybe. And there's no goodie bag at the end of this that we are going to be wrestling for as to who won the debate. And so let's get away from those kind of childish competitions. And let's focus on the topic, what is new politics to begin with? How does one even define new politics? And how do we contrast it to what we are talking about as old politics? At the end of the day, what does every citizen of this country want? They want good politics. Good politics. You can call it new, you can call it old, you can call it stale, you can call it old-fashioned. They want good politics. And by good politics, what do the young of this country want? They want people not offering apologies. I mean, look at what happened just in the recent past. There's Rajnath who apologizes to the Muslims, then someone else says, no, he actually didn't apologize to the Muslims. Then there's Rahul who refuses to apologize to the Sikhs. Then there is Kejriwal who expects everybody to apologize to him. And then, of course, there is Modi who thinks the world owes him an apology. In all of this, the youth are really not concerned. 70 million unemployed young people. They are restless. They are impatient. They are ambitious. They are global citizens. They want jobs. I haven't heard the J word uttered by the two gentlemen here this evening. Jobs. They want jobs. They don't want jokes. So the question is, new politics, if it speaks a new language, and that new language which will appeal to the 30 and younger people of India, who will be the game changers during the next election, those and the female vote, I haven't heard the female narrative in any political agenda so far, which really surprises me, considering it was the female vote that actually, in many ways, propelled Mr. Kejriwal in Delhi. That has been spectacularly ignored, and I don't speak on behalf of his party or any party for that matter. I'm very fortunate. We are still a democracy. I'm still an independent voice. I can still speak my mind. I can still come here to Kolkata and say what I need to say without any fear that it will either be misrepresented, misunderstood, or am I going to be shivering that there's going to be a vindictive next government coming into power, which may well happen, but we'll deal with it when that time comes. In the meanwhile, we've got all kinds of megalomaniacs. There's dynasty to deal with. There are people who are boasting about their chest size. I mean, I'm asking this audience, an educated, informed, very alive audience, to have a future prime ministerial candidate boast about his 56-inch chest. How would it be if, say, a female candidate talked about her D-cup bra? Would that be accepted in exactly the same spirit? So this kind of chest thumping, this is what we have reduced political debate to. This is political chest thumping at its most childish and its most ridiculous. So we are talking about governance. These are all cliches. The young don't want to know. They don't want people to give them bhashans about governance and we need governance. It's a given. Of course you need governance. Why would you imagine that new politics rules out good governance? There is a change. The change is evident. It's palpable. Everybody can feel it. Kejriwal was merely a catalyst. I'm not even saying he'll make a great prime minister. We know he didn't even make a good chief minister for those 49 days. That's besides the point. He has driven something into our hearts and heads, which is telling us there is hope for the future. If we do not support the Kejriwals in our midst, whether we agree with their politics or not, if we don't vote for change, we are going to be stuck with the same old people for 66 years who have ruined the country. Today we have a Sahara, 2.5 crore poor people whose salaries have disappeared down the tube. Not a single political party is talking about them. Why? Why are they all mums? Why are they all mum? Because they're basically all on the same side. There's no difference when it comes to scandals, when it comes to scams, when it comes to our defense. The way we have seen in the last few days, 30-year-old subs, young people dying because of corruption with the bureaucracy, with the political establishment. Yet they're all mum. They all stand together. It's a conspiracy of silence. If we don't take the opportunity for change now, we are doomed for the next 50 years. So new politics is the future, and we have to vote for it if India is to survive.
Thank you. That's a spirited speech.